set of growing pains and experience with her the good times.
The thing I love the most was the cats.
And the bad.
She was far gone. I was afraid we were going to lose her.
And we'll see how Tracy overcame adversity and found love.
The first impression was, what a steal.
This is Tracy Gold, Celebrity Profile.
I'm really fortunate. I have everything. Not to sound gloating, but, you know.
Tracy Gold was born Tracy Claire Fisher on May 16, 1969, in New York City. Tracy's mother, Bonnie.
The most wonderful little girl you'd ever imagine. From the day Tracy was born, when I took her home from the hospital, she slept till 10 o'clock the next morning. That's why I had four others after Tracy, because she was so wonderful.
14 months after her birth, Tracy was joined by a sister, Melissa, who was nicknamed Missy.
It was Irish twins. And they were inseparable, and they have been since the day Missy was born.
In 1973, a bitter divorce tore Tracy's family apart. Bonnie gained custody of 4-year-old Tracy and 3-year-old Missy.
It was a very sad time for me. And I had this little girl who would come to me when I'd be crying or I would be upset. And she would say to me, Mommy, it's going to be okay. I'm going to take care of you.
Shortly after her divorce, Bonnie began dating a struggling actor named Harry Gold.
They adored him. They loved him. Harry Gold, they called him. Not Harry. Harry Gold.
We loved him immediately. He was awesome.
She's beautiful. Funny. Adorable. I fell in love with her and her sister, Melissa, you know, almost at the same time that I fell in love with my wife.
It was Harry who accidentally launched 4-year-old Tracy's acting career.
I had an audition for a Pepsi print ad. So I walked there with Tracy.
So we said to her, okay, now you sit down here. And when I come out, we're going to go home. And he gave her her book and her lollipop and what have you. Next thing he knows, he comes out of his interview. She's nowhere around.
They were auditioning like little girls. And they said all the little girls who, you know, for the commercial, like, and they took them all in. And I walked in with them. And then they called my dad, my dad's agent. Then they said, we want to book Tracy. And he's like, no, you mean Harry. And they're like, no, Tracy. And they're like, well, Tracy's 4. She's not an actress. And they're like, well, we have a picture of her here.
She ends up being in the ad. I don't even think they took my picture. And that was the beginning of, the modest beginning of Tracy's career.
At age 5, Tracy graduated to television commercials.
I could always, like, do dialogue right away. I could, like, you know, memorize lines and stuff.
It was a happy time for Tracy, a little girl with a big imagination.
I guess I was, like, a bit of a princess, a little bit eccentric.
She had this hat that she called her long hair hat. And it was a stocking cap with, like, a long braid on the back of it. She always wanted to wear her long hair hat.
She would wear this hat, and she thought it was her real hair. And, I mean, she would go to bed at night, and she would curl it, and she would take the curls down in the morning. And no one could convince her that that wasn't real hair.
Tracy's always been ultra-feminine. You know, loved the dolls, loved the frilly dresses, and, you know, have her hair done.
Although Harry and Bonnie weren't married, they raised Tracy and Missy together. In March of 1975, the family headed west so Harry could pursue his acting career.
We moved to California. We drove across. We had this car we had picked up for $600, this old Chevy Impala.
When we arrived in New York, in California, we came along the coast, and all of a sudden I saw the ocean, and for some reason, I don't know, I was a strange child. I, like, broke out into, this land is your land, this land is...
Totally butchering the words, you know, this land is my land. I laughed my head off. It was so funny. But, you know, she was that way.
On August 23rd, 1975, shortly after arriving in California, Bonnie and Harry Gold tied the knot.
My parents got married when I was 6, and Missy and I were the little flower girls in the wedding. And the invitation actually read, Harry, Bonnie, Tracy, and Missy are in love, so they're getting married.
It was a typical 70s wedding, and Harry sang his vows to me, and I recited my vows to Harry. And then each of the girls came up.
She and Missy said their own version of vows. It was very funny.
She goes, before I met Harry Gold, I had a terrible life. But then Harry Gold came and married my mom and me and Missy, and now we're going to be happy forever.
After the wedding, Harry Gold adopted Tracy and Missy. Harry and Bonnie then allowed the girls to pursue acting.
They were going to a public school, and I wanted them to go to a private school, so I figured this would be a way for them to get money to go to a private school, because I didn't know how Harry's acting career was going to work out. So I figured they'd do commercials. Boy, did they do commercials.
It's one of those things that it's like a snowball effect. And I really loved it, you know. I really liked doing it. And then when I was six, the first dramatic thing I did was Roots. Robert Reed was my father. And I thought that was the best thing, because that's like Dad Brady.
Missy was also acting, and the girls often competed against each other for roles. But sometimes they worked together.
We were Captains and the Kings, and we did Little Mo. We looked a lot alike. She was just the blonde hair, blue-eyed version of me. But Missy and I could always really cry really easily. So it was like we were perfect for it, you know. And we liked working together. I mean, we auditioned up against each other all the time. But Missy and I had been best friends forever.
The only problem we ever had with them was they were never going to make friends. It just was the two of them, so my husband would get very, very upset. So one day the two of them took off with their bicycles, and they went down the hill, and my husband made them separate to make friends, come back with a new friend. They couldn't find them. I found them sitting at the bottom of the hill, drinking a soda. The two of them saying, can we come home now? We can't find any other friends. It's just the two of us.
But not for long. In 1977, the Golds added baby sister Brandy to the family.
Yeah, I was real maternal from very early on. I remember when I was 8 years old changing Brandy's diaper.
When we return, an audition nearly turns into tragedy.
I look over and Tracy's unconscious, right, with blood coming from her head.
And later, Tracy's encounter with a pop superstar.
I can't even explain it to this day. It's one of my biggest humiliations.
It was TV's longest three-hour tour.
I've used up every way to fall down and knock myself out.
But it wasn't all smooth sailing.
He was a difficult kind of person, in a way.
Through public scandals.
When Bob Denver was arrested, it threw the whole network into a crisis.
And private pain.
It was one of the saddest moments that I can remember.
The full tale of the seven castaways can now be told.
I don't know where my life will take me.
It's the story you haven't heard. Gilligan's Island, tonight at 9 on the E! True Hollywood Story.
The Spot Lifter is Bissell's wash it down, lift it up, get on with your life, cordless deep cleaner. Life's messy. Clean it up.
Hi, Mom, it's me again.
How stuffed is overstuffed? The giblets will be in the gravy, thanks.
You're kidding, no pepper? What am I forgetting?
I want to call Mom back?
Nope, I've got it.
They're going to love these.
You said it.
Great holiday meals start with flaky, buttery-tasting Pillsbury Crescent Rolls. Make their holiday the Doughboy way.
Ooh, pretty impressive.
I wonder where she gets it from.
I wonder.
Take a breath. Notice anything? Well, if you happen to have a Tic Tac in your mouth, you would. You notice your breath tastes fresh. People around you would notice your fresh breath, too. Can you breathe without a Tic Tac? Of course. But I wouldn't recommend it.
I'm here to see if an expert can taste the difference between butter and new parquet.
You, sir, are from
Oregon.
I would have thought Idaho. Let's just do it.
Mmm. It's butter.
Parquet.
The richest, creamiest parquet ever.
Nothing says
butter
like new parquet.
Party time for Alaska.
This Christmas, Jim Carrey is Andy Kaufman.
I've always got to be one step ahead of them.
And Andy Kaufman is
insane.
Comic genius.
Crazy.
Brilliant.
The Man on the Moon, rated R, starts December 22nd.
Ever have that dream where you're driving, introducing the next Celica?
Go!
This portion of E! Is brought to you by the next Celica. Roads with curves, good. Roads without curves, bad.
By 1977, 8-year-old Tracy Gold had already appeared in numerous commercials and a few television movies. Tracy's mother recalls her eldest daughter was a natural.
She did Dark Secrets of Harvest Home, and she had scenes with Bette Davis, and she was incredible. She was able just to focus and do it and then come out of it, and your mind was blown.
By age 10, Tracy Gold was a very busy actress.
I liked going on the set and just proving that I wasn't like going to be like some dorky kid coming on and, you know, not being able to keep up with the adult actors. And I liked surprising them that I could.
Beau Bridges co-starred with Tracy in the 1979 TV movie, The Child Stealer.
She was just a good actress, and that she seemed to enjoy it a lot. She hadn't lost the sense of play and fun.
It was like all this crying and emoting, and I liked doing that because it was fun for me.
She loved it. She loved being on the sets. She loved the art. She loved the people. It was her life. It's in her blood.
In 1979, both Tracy and her sister Missy were regulars on television series. Tracy played Shirley Jones's daughter in the series Shirley.
Missy was working on Benson, and when they would get their desserts at night, they would call each other, and they wouldn't eat it until they were on the phone with each other.
At home, Tracy, Missy, and baby Brandy were inseparable.
There's this game that the three of us used to play when I was really little. It was a game called Allie. And we would be chased by somebody, then they would have to protect me, because I was Allie. And we'd go into our little playhouse, and we'd lock ourselves in there, oh, Allie, Allie, and we'd carry Brandy. It was Missy, Brandy, and I. Allie, Allie, come, we've got to rescue you. And Brandy'd be lying there. For hours, we could get lost in this game.
She loved the idea of the make-believe, you know, because that's what acting is so much of, is being able to play that game completely. And she would be so lost in the thing. It's the same energy and concentration that she would bring to her work as an actress.
In December of 1980, Tracy's childhood and thriving career nearly came to an end while on the way to an audition for the feature film, Shoot the Moon.
So I'm looking over my lines, and the next thing I remember, we were like broadsided by a car.
She didn't even see it coming because her head was engrossed in the sides that she was looking at. Spinning around, and trying to control the car, glass everywhere. And I look over and Tracy's unconscious, right? With blood coming from her head.
I was knocked unconscious and taken to the hospital.
Tracy was lying there, her face was swollen. Harry was sitting there wrapped up, and my husband almost passed out.
And I had 65 stitches on the side of my face. See, right here.
And she still has these little scars here that always remind me that happened. It was horrible. I thought she was dead.
Less than a month after the accident, the Golds celebrated the holidays.
It was one of the best Christmases we ever had in our lives, because you get this close to losing what makes life important. That was a great Christmas.
Tracy's audition for the film Shoot the Moon was postponed due to her accident. When she finally read for the role, Tracy won the part. Tracy began filming in the beginning of 1981. The film starred Albert Finney and Diane Keaton.
They were so nice and so down to earth. I remember when I finished shooting, Diane Keaton gave us all like the most amazing gifts. She bought me this huge like doll, this stuffed doll, and I still have it.
For Tracy, doing Shoot the Moon was a wonderful professional experience, but personally, it was a traumatic time.
I done Shoot the Moon in January. And we had moved from an old house to a new house while I was away doing the movie. So for me, change was just freaking me out.
She was starting to get withdrawal from herself. It was her personality that first hit me. I would notice Tracy sitting in corners, like all huddled up and everything. And then finally one day, I saw her in the bathtub and she was like down to nothing.
I was starting to mature a little bit and develop and all those things that happen when you're 12. And it just scared me because I had such a safe environment at home because I was sheltered. I was really sheltered. And it scared me, the prospect of like growing up, getting older and moving out of the house.
In a misguided attempt to forestall puberty, Tracy starved herself. She was anorexic.
I just kind of got into this pattern of not eating and just skipping meals.
Started going to the doctor and we seemed to get it under control and everything was fine.
We thought, we caught it, out of here, 12 years old. Look at this, aren't we wonderful? I quickly got better because for me, the emotional turmoil that I was putting my family through, and my whole motto was to be a good kid, was really upsetting to me, and I didn't want to upset them, and I didn't want to be the one that everybody was, like, looking at.
We didn't realize that. We thought she was getting better for her, for the right reasons. It never dawned on us that she was getting better for us.
When we return, Tracy surrenders her ego to win the part that made her famous.
I felt so stupid, and they put glasses on me, and they really dorked me up.
Nobody in America sells more office products to more businesses than Office Depot.
You can shop our store.
Taking care of business.
Or you can...
Taking care of business. It's all mine. Taking care of business and working overtime. Work out.
Office Depot. Taking care of business.
Your mother and I want you to have this.
Credit card.
You know, for emergencies.
Thanks.
They ran a pizza!
Emergency.
Dad! There's an easier way to teach your kids about credit. Call for your free copy of How Credit Cards Work. See? There's always something more to discover.
Oh. It's okay. It's only a Corolla. Move it up!
The 2000s.
For the holidays, come to MarthaStewart.com.
Raindrops and roses and whiskers on kittens. Bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens. Brown paper. Doorbells and sled bells and schnitzel with noodles. Wild geese that fly with the moon on their wings. These are a few of my favorite things.
Shop now, and with your next purchase online, I'll send you my special entertaining magazine, free as my gift to you.
In 1983, after a bout with anorexia, 14-year-old Tracy Gold returned to work. Tracy appeared in four TV movies and co-starred in the series Goodnight Beantown. Gold's busy schedule left her little time to socialize.
I was pretty naive about boys, and I looked from afar.
Tracy's sister, Brandy.
Bottom line, she didn't have enough time. She had no time to date because she was working and then coming home and relaxing. I would go and I would work there and I'd be like with all the adults, and I never really knew how to talk to people my own age.
Then Tracy went a little boy crazy. Gold's mom, Bonnie, remembers her daughter's first crush.
There were Rick Springfield posters, there was Rick Springfield records, there was Rick Springfield. I love Rick Springfield written all over the house.
Sister Missy helped Tracy meet the pop idol.
Missy's working on Benson, so opportunities arise. So who's working right next to her, because she's at the ABC lot, but Rick Springfield on the General Hospital set. So it gets arranged, we get to meet him, we have this big meeting. I was just so socially retarded that I like met him in a stupid bear hat. I'm 14 years old and I wore a bear hat. Why? I can't even explain it to this day. It's one of my biggest humiliations.
Tracy was also embarrassed by a more serious problem, her performance at school.
I could go on a set and I could learn lines and I could memorize them and have no problem. And then I get into school and you give me a geometry problem and I was a total idiot. I mean, you know, I was failing.
And I'd see her study her ass off, just keep studying. And then she'd go in and come home from school crying because she didn't do well.
Tracy was afflicted with attention deficit disorder, more commonly known as ADD.
Once we found out about it and realized that this is what she was suffering from, you know, it was like, oh my God, finally we understand this, you know? Because we could not get it as parents. Then, you know, once we learned about ADD, we figured out a method of studying with her that was effective.
In early 1985, 15-year-old Tracy auditioned for a new sitcom called Growing Pains. She didn't get the part. 2 months later, the show was recast. the producers of Growing Pains called Tracy's father, Harry Gold. In 1982, Gold quit acting and established a successful talent agency representing numerous actors.
You know, by this time I was her agent, and I'm saying, nah, we're not coming back to go through the whole friggin' process on this thing again.
I'm like, why do I even have to go in again? They saw me, they didn't like me, I'm not going back in.
But Gold did go back in, and she won the part of Carol Seaver. Growing Pains co-star, Joanna Kearns.
She was very sweet, but very shy and kind of reticent to, feel like she was part of the group. But within, you know, a short amount of time, we teased her into it, and she was one of us.
Tracy Gold was very different from Carol Seaver.
I felt so stupid, and they put glasses on me, and they really dorked me up. I mean, they didn't let me wear makeup, nothing. They wanted me to be like brainy Carol Seaver.
Growing Pains co-star Alan Thicke.
She played it with a wonderful straightness and conviction, which is what made the character so funny in contrast to Mike, who was such a goofball.
The first few seasons on Growing Pains could not have been better for Tracy.
The thing I loved the most was the cast. I loved them, and it felt like a family to me.
We were truly an extended family, as corny as that sounds. There would never be a birthday party, a Halloween party, a Valentine's party, a Christmas party that anybody had without the whole group being invited.
Tracy also enjoyed showing off her dramatic talent in the show's more serious episodes.
The drunk driving one with Matthew Perry. It's one of my favorites.
Carol Sandy just died.
Michael Seaver, that is the sickest joke that I have ever heard, and I am never going to forgive you. It was really wretching. It was a hard episode to watch. This isn't fair. What happened to a second chance? I was really pleased with my performance. It's just for me, it was like a real acting stretch.
I always loved doing scenes with Tracy because I would get so much back in terms of the acting.
Coming up, a big surprise for Tracy.
We are conspirators, aren't we? We're romantic conspirators.
But first, Tracy confronts an old enemy.
I remember her just not eating. The eating days went away.
Would you like to shop in style for free? Just enter eOnline Style Holiday Gift Guide Sweepstakes. Every week you can win $1,000 worth of new merchandise from e-tailers like Gateway, Beauty.com, and GiftCertificates.com. Just click the gift guide on eOnline's homepage. Now until December 31st, you'll find everything on your gift list. Fashion, beauty, music, books, and electronics. And don't forget to register and win a free holiday shopping spree. Log on to www.eonline.com and celebrate your holidays in style.
AT&T 00 info.
I need a phone number. The Mystery Bookstore? I don't have a clue which town.
Now you don't need the exact location.
Found it.
AT&T customers dial 00 for directory assistance.
Oh, oh, it's magic. Yes, no.
All his life, Tom Ripley has known what he wants.
What did you actually do in New York?
Forging signatures, impersonating practically anybody.
What?
And he's just figured out...
I wish I could live Dickie's life for him.
...how to get it.
Where's Dickie?
Your guess is as good as mine.
The guy's just disappeared off the face of the earth.
Matt Damon, Gwyneth Paltrow, Jude Law.
Hello, Marty.
The talented Mr. Ripley, rated R. Christmas Day in theaters everywhere.
Pikachu, Bulbasaur, Kangaskhan,
Golem, Caputo,
Meowth,
Jigglypuff.
If that's how your kids talk, then come to Burger King. Now every Burger King Big Kids meal comes with a Pokemon toy and trading card or Master Trainer trading card sheet.
Perfect gift for your child. Visit eToys, and it will come to you.
It's form that touches our lives, and function that enlivens it. It's poetry that clutches the heart, and technology that makes it race. It's science that makes us see, and design that makes our eyes wide. It's the fusion of all these things. That is the power of AND. The power of AND. The fusion of design and technology. Cadillac.
To win over this crowd,
Electric Sting!
You've got to perform the new Norelco Quadra Action Razor with slots to cut long hairs and holes to get the short stubble for a quick close shave guaranteed. Yeah! The new Quadra Action Razor, Norelco. Put it to the test.
This Christmas, give her diamonds from K Jewelers. Diamonds hand-selected for extraordinary color and clarity. Like K's diamond solitaire earrings starting from $99.95. With diamonds from K Jewelers, you will make her very happy.
Hi, I'm Jane Krakowski, and you are watching E! Entertainment Television.
By 1988, 19-year-old Tracy Gold successfully battled anorexia and attention deficit disorder. That fall, she began her fourth season on Growing Pains. Unlike other teen celebrities who enjoy a Hollywood lifestyle, Tracy preferred to be a homebody.
She never really wanted to go out and sneak beer or anything like that, or to go to big parties. She was never about that. She was really focused on acting. She was really focused on her life and just on her family.
Growing up, there was just never any need to look outside of our house. It was like having my best friend spend the night every night, and we had the best time. I would always find I would like hang out with other people, and there's just so much like expository work you have to do in order to get to know somebody that I just never had the patience to do it. And I never felt like I could open up to people, even as a kid, as much as I could to my sisters.
Tracy moved out of her parents' house in 1988, but she didn't go far. Tracy's new home was a guest house in the backyard.
She designed it. She built it. She was in there with, you know, architects and what have you, doing the most incredible job on that house you'd ever want to see.
She liked being there. She felt safe there. And I think that's a big part of Tracy's personality, is that she likes to feel safe. And she felt safe at home.
That feeling of safety didn't last.
There was about a year there that I gained weight. And you can see it on Growing Pains. I mean, there's a period of time there where I look chunky. And there were a lot of jokes made about it in the script.
She felt at times that in the writing, in the material, that she was being made fun of. But I don't think anyone realized the severity of her condition and how she took this. I mean, I think the writers were writing stuff that a teenage brother would say to his teenage sister.
Tracy became determined to lose weight.
I was sent to an endocrinologist, and we told him that I had had a bout with anorexia. He put me on a 500-calorie diet and said, you can lose weight in like 2 months. I lost like 20 pounds.
Tracy went from 133 pounds to 112.
When Tracy first started losing weight, I was like, wow, Tracy, you look so awesome. Everybody was like, you look amazing.
What that meant to Tracy was, lose more weight and she'd be even more amazing.
When you get that kind of reaffirmation, it plays with your head and you just start going. And you just keep going. And I did. I just thought, well, if this is great, then wait till they see, you know?
During the fourth season of Growing Pains, a svelte and confident Tracy met her soulmate.
Robbie and Tracy, that from the moment they set eyes on each other, it was all over.
Robbie was Robbie Marshall, a former lifeguard from New Jersey who was working as a production assistant on a Joanna Kearns film.
The first impression was, what a steal. I gotta make her mine before somebody else finds her and takes her on me.
It's the first time I'd ever seen my sister interested or excited about a guy, ever.
As the relationship grew, Gold continued to struggle with her weight.
I plateaued for a little bit and I stayed the same weight, and then I would lose a little bit more weight. I don't think I ever really thought I had a problem.
Tracy did her best to disguise her dieting. Growing Pains co-star Jeremy Miller.
She looked a little thin in the face, but she wore a lot of sweats and a lot of sweatshirts and a lot of baggy clothes.
But the Gold family wasn't fooled.
It was a big deal in the family. I mean, we recognized the symptoms of what was going on very early.
I had noticed her not eating. I had noticed the doors closed, and I had caught her throwing up. I had caught her with diuretics.
In April 1990, the Golds insisted Tracy begin treatment for anorexia. But the therapy didn't help. Tracy's eating habits became more extreme and her health more precarious.
I remember her just not eating. The eating days went away and she just didn't eat. And it was hard for us to even get her to eat.
Tracy was slipping away from Robbie, and Robbie could see it. Tracy was so insecure.
I tried everything. I tried getting mad. I tried loving her to death. I tried everything I could think of, and it just, it had to come from within her. Nothing I could do or say would make any difference.
Do you know that Robbie nailed her bathroom door closed in her trailer so that she couldn't get into the bathroom and vomit if she needed to?
In the summer of 1991, Bonnie discovered Tracy's condition was more severe than the family realized.
We were up in Big Bear, and she went in to get changed, and she took off a sweater. And it was like in a movie. I saw her back, and I saw her bones. I literally was on my knees in that dressing room crying. And all she was doing was, it's going to be okay, I promise. I promise, I'm going to eat.
But Tracy didn't eat.
You're watching someone that you love with your whole heart and soul destroy themselves in front of you, and you can't stop them.
Tracy's younger sister, Jessie.
Even as young as I was, I knew something was wrong, so every night, even school days, anything, I slept with her. I slept in her house, I slept in her bed. All I knew was that she was sick, something was wrong.
It wasn't cancer. It wasn't a disease that you got and you couldn't control. She wasn't eating, she was doing it to herself.
And I know her parents were in agony over it. I also know they didn't really know what to do, but I think the pressure of performing every week and the fear that if she did go in and get help, people would find out was what kept her sick.
By December 1991, 22-year-old Tracy's health was in real danger.
Well, she was far gone. I was afraid we were going to lose her, and I went as far as to call the studio.
Executives at Warner Brothers told Tracy that she needed to gain weight over the Christmas break.
Couldn't gain it, so I came back from Christmas and I had lost weight and I was sick with bronchitis or something. And they had a doctor come to the set. They said, take the rest of the day off, you're sick.
Later that day, Harry Gold received a phone call from a studio executive telling him that Tracy needed to check into a hospital for treatment.
The people at Warner Brothers, they really pulled together and were able to be as supportive as they could for Tracy and allow her to go off and get herself better. I mean, they were awesome.
When Celebrity Profile returns, Tracy faces her darkest hour.
I was like, oh my God, I could die. I could die right now because my body looks like it should be dead.
And later, a dream comes true for Tracy.
She just went wild and, you know, was so happy.
It was TV's longest three-hour tour.
I've used up every way to fall down and knock myself out.
But it wasn't all smooth sailing.
He was a difficult kind of person, in a way.
Through public scandals.
When Bob Denver was arrested, it threw the whole network into a crisis.
And private pain.
It was one of the saddest moments that I can remember.
The full tale of the seven castaways can now be told.
I don't know where my life will take me.
It's the story you haven't heard. Gilligan's Island, tonight at 9 on the E! True Hollywood Story.
Three motorcycles passed here. Three men, two women, all carrying visa cards.
Don't
you know that, grandfather? Because Central Law's Motorcycle Adventures doesn't take.
American Express.
Central Law's will take you to a place beyond your imagination, but they won't take American Express. Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
He called in sick. He sounded awful.
Giving your kid cold medicine can be... But now there's delicious soft chews tablets from Triaminic that dissolve magically in an instant. Easy to give, easy to take soft chews come in three delicious formulas for the right relief without the struggle.
Better?
Yeah.
Bye.
Make room for shoes. The world's biggest shoe store is here. Nordstromshoes.com.
Introducing a cardboard applicator tampon that lets you feel this fresh, feel this clean. New Silklide odor-absorbing tampons are the only cardboard applicator tampons that eliminate odor by absorbing it. Naturally, it's the freshest idea yet from Playtex.
Rolling Stone calls it the most influential show of the decade. The E! True Hollywood Story. Now on every night at 9 p.m. Only on E!
By January 1992, 22-year-old Tracy Gold was in failing health. Suffering from anorexia, Tracy weighed close to 90 pounds. On January 12th, Gold took a leave of absence from growing pains to seek treatment at a hospital.
It was kind of a psychiatric hospital, but they also had an eating disorder like unit, but they were horrible.
We'd take her calls and listen to her cry, but we said we weren't going to get her, but she could walk out, you know, so she got herself a cab and she left.
I got referred to the eating disorder, the head of eating disorders over at UCLA. His name was Michael Strober.
The concern I had initially was that she was going to need care within a hospital setting. She was extremely reluctant to do that. So the treatment that followed was intensive outpatient therapy with nutrition counseling and family support.
Meanwhile, Growing Pains was in its seventh season, but the show had run out of steam. ABC canceled the sitcom. The cast, minus Tracy, prepared to tape the final episode in March of 1992. But Tracy was determined to be on the set for the last show. After only a few weeks of treatment with Dr. Strober, Tracy returned to the soundstage at Warner Brothers.
It was terrifying for Tracy. She held on to me and I held on to her as she walked onto that set. And they had everything ready for her.
She wasn't out of the woods at all when she came back for the last episode, but it would have been very painful for all of us to end the last episode without her. We had to have her. I remember there was a scene in the front room where we all sat around and ate pizza, and if you look at the footage, she never touched it. She was painfully thin at that time.
Growing Pains, Tracy's home away from home for 7 years, was suddenly and permanently gone. After the show ended, Tracy's life was consumed by her battle with anorexia.
I was the classic case. I was always trying to please everybody. I was, you know, I was so afraid of change. I was, I think I would compromise myself to make other people happy.
Fundamental to anorexia nervosa is a belief that one is inadequate, average, plain, lacking in distinctiveness or specialness.
I think so much had to do with her and my relationship to make me not feel guilty, to make me not feel like I was a bad parent because my ex-husband had walked out on them when they were young. And I think that weighed heavily on her.
According to Dr. Strober, Tracy dealt with her feelings of helplessness by not eating and purging.
I wanted to, like, feel control, you know? So that's the best way to feel control. It's not the best way, but I thought it was.
In the February 1992 issue of People magazine, Tracy reluctantly talked about her anorexia for the first time.
It had come out in, like, Inquirer, Star, you know, so you imagine you're, like, suffering through this. Your whole life is crumbling in front of you. You walk into the 7-Eleven, and it's right there. You're on the cover, and they're dramatizing it in a way that it's not true, and it felt so invasive. And so, like, I did the article for People magazine, and it was just so that I could, like, speak, like, have my voice heard.
Speaking out about the disease also helped Tracy stop denying she was ill.
When it came public, she finally had to come to grips with it and realize what she was doing to herself, that there's consequences to it. It involves a lot of people.
Tracy wanted to get well, but recovery wasn't easy.
When I did the thing for People, I was still on my way to losing more. I mean, I was so far getting better.
Once weight loss begins in anorexia nervosa, it becomes a forward-moving and accelerating process that you really can't contain.
By May 1992, Tracy gained back 5 pounds. She weighed 95. Then she had a relapse. Once again, the weight dropped off.
Couldn't understand how she could be doing something to herself that was, in essence, killing herself.
Sometimes it was like being in love with a cactus, you know? You wanted to hug her, and she was just so prickly, you couldn't get near her.
I was really obnoxious. I was really hard, you know, and really not fun to be around, and really just turning him away and just saying, I want my space.
I just knew that somewhere inside there was the person that I fell in love with, and I'd be damned if I was going to lose her to this.
He loved me, and he helped me, and he talked to me, and he understood me, and he pushed me, but knew how to push enough and not too much.
During the summer of 1992, Tracy's weight continued to drop. By September, she weighed just 80 pounds.
It was either a point where Tracy was going to turn around, or we were going to lose her.
A revelation marked the start of Tracy's comeback.
Got up in the middle of the night one night, and I looked at myself in the mirror, and I just looked, and I was like, because my heart was beating really fast. I was like, oh my God, I could die. I could die right now because my body looks like it should be dead. And then I'd die, and everybody would look, and they would, like, know what had killed me.
Tracy realized that she was about to be left behind, you know. I really wanted to go on with my life and have her in it.
She loved Robbie more than anything in this world. And unless she got better, Robbie wouldn't marry her. It was love, it was true love that made Tracy pull it together and say, I don't want to die.
It was enough for me to want to get married, to want to have children. I could see the other side, and where I was wasn't so good. And I wanted all those things, and the only way I could get them was to start to get better.
In April of 1993, ABC journalist Diane Sawyer interviewed Tracy about her anorexia.
One of the things she says is that you can be, in a way, seduced by the fact that you're small and waif-like, and everyone wants to take care of you, so that it has this completely circular reasoning that will take place inside your head.
For Robbie Marshall, the Diane Sawyer interview presented a golden opportunity when the story aired on Primetime Live on May 6, 1993.
He knew he wanted to marry me, so he came up with this idea to have Diane Sawyer ask me on the air.
We are conspirators, aren't we? We're romantic conspirators.
The whole family gathered around the living room floor.
We were watching it in our family room, with my whole family there.
And now a footnote. Tracy's boyfriend, Robbie, is so convinced she's ready for that piece of cake, he told us that at this moment, after the story airs on the West Coast, he's going to ask Tracy to marry him.
And so I got down on one knee, and I proposed to her. I had the ring in my pocket, and I did it right in front of her whole family.
And he opened the box, and I thought Tracy was going to just pass out in front of all of us. And just started screaming, I will, I love you, I love you.
She just went wild. You know, it was so happy and full of joy and glee, and we had balloons, we had everything going on. It was a beautiful moment.
Coming up, Tracy discovers a different kind of bliss.
I've never seen her more alive.
She battled prejudice with her groundbreaking series.
There were stations in the South that refused to even put the show on the air.
Made headlines with her controversial relationships.
It was very shocking then.
And turned a personal crisis into a crusade.
She wanted to be inspirational to women.
Hear how Diane Carroll overcame obstacles on her way to stardom.
I never thought that this was going to be an easy thing to do.
Real stars, real stories. Diane Carroll's Celebrity Profile. This Wednesday at 10, only on E!
Do you want to help with the dishes?
No.
I'll make dessert.
Okay.
Introducing new Pillsbury One-Step Brownie in its own ready-to-bake pan. Just pop it in the oven.
Whoa!
And eat.
I'm done.
Done?
Brownies.
Wow, Mom.
With new Pillsbury One-Step Brownie, a great dessert is just one step away.
Thanks for your help.
Don't mention it.
Also, try One-Step Cookie for a snack.
I love the tropics.
Everything is so green.
Green? Hi-ho, Kermit the Frog here.
Here for Sesame Street's 30th anniversary. It's Jim Henson's magic-talking Kermit the Frog. When kids squeeze him, he sings.
I'm a Caribbean amphibian.
Hey, what a neat song.
I like to hop.
Just try and stop him. He keeps humming.
Nice dancing, Bert.
Thank you.
This Kermit even catches flies.
Delicious.
Hi, I'm Sarah Jessica Parker, and you're watching E! Entertainment. I can't believe I got to do that.
Now there's a new way to get 16 of today's hottest stars.
stars on one CD. Hit the net to get Pop to the Power of 16. Click on the site below to get yours. 16 chart-topping songs, including 5, Christina Aguilera, Hanson, and Billy Crawford. Get your favorite pop superstars on Pop to the Power of 16. Get Pop to the Power of 16 on compact disc for only $16.99 when you jump to the site below and get access to the best that pop has to offer. If you want to be my lover, you gotta get with my friend. Pop's greatest hits from Spice Girls, Steps, Monica, Billy, and Christian Davis. 16 of today's hottest young stars on one CD. Get Pop to the Power of 16 for only $16.99 plus $4.95 shipping and handling when you lock to some of the best tunes on the net at the3ws.poptothepower.com and get yours today.
At the start of 1993, 23-year-old Tracy Gold was recovering from a four-year battle with anorexia. In February, she went back to work in the TV film Labor of Love. The movie was shot in North Carolina.
And we thought about it, and she wanted to do it. It's like, okay, you know, I've been this far. I'm going to do this movie.
I think I was really scared because I was going to North Carolina to go away from home. And I've already said I'm a real homebody, so I was changing the routine, the regimen, you know. And I wasn't, you know, better. I was, you know, on my way and well enough to work.
It's kind of like, though, when, you know, you get somebody out of a hospital and the first time they're back to work, you know, you're worried about them. And it was still a tenuous time for us.
I'm really thin in that movie. But I was well enough to work, and it was incentive, you know, to get back on a set.
In 1994, Tracy was offered the role of an anorexic in another television movie, For the Love of Nancy. Instead, she agreed to act as a consultant. Producer Lloyd Weintraub.
I got a curious call from her agent, Harry, asking if Tracy can come in and meet with me.
And I was like, you know what, I'm going to do this, because another actress doing this isn't going to have the invested interest that I have doing it.
She made sure that they got it right, because she knew.
I am not scared, and I am not going to some hospital to talk about what I eat and what I don't eat. I hear about it 24 hours a damn day. Nancy, did you eat? Nancy, what did you eat?
Tracy was healthy enough that she needed makeup to appear anorexic.
I remember the network calling and saying, she looks too sick. And I'm like, good. You know, because that's what it's really like. It's hard to look at. So you look like it really is, you know? And that was my purpose. And I think it really did a lot of good.
One of the main reasons that she wanted so badly to portray this character was her way of reaching out to the countless thousands of other people who might be suffering from anorexia.
For Tracy, the film marked a milestone.
I was a little bit nervous about what it would do for my psyche, and I think it only helped me. And I think I increasingly got better.
She could be an actress now, not an anorexic, not an actress with anorexia, but she was an actress playing an anorexic.
Tracy's a terrific actress, whether she's playing a role that involves anorexia or not. She's just so full of life.
October 8th, 1994, marked a different type of milestone for Gold. On that day, 25-year-old Tracy married Robbie Marshall, her boyfriend of 5 years.
Oh, I had the best wedding. When Tracy turns around at the end, and she's just gotten married, and she's standing there with Robbie, his hand up like this. He goes, yes. It defined the whole moment. Yes. Look what I've done. I'm here. I'm alive.
She looked just radiant. She couldn't have been a more beautiful bride.
I designed it from like beginning to end because, of course, like every girl's fantasy. I knew how I wanted my wedding. I knew how I wanted my dress. I knew everything.
An elaborate wedding, beautiful, every trick in the book. And I was going to suffer through it for her if she could only get herself better. And not just gain some weight for the wedding and then back to her same old routine, but she had to be ready to have a piece of wedding cake.
I did eat the wedding cake. I didn't eat a piece. I had a bite. And that was a big thing for me. I hadn't had cake. I didn't do any test runs. So that was the first piece I had had like in a long time of cake.
It was almost like the celebration of the culmination of her getting well and now being able to move on to her life and you know, to marry this great guy. And
she found the one guy that she wanted to marry, and that he's her soulmate. Robbie is Tracy's soulmate.
Following her acclaimed performance in For the Love of Nancy, Tracy was again in demand as an actress. During 1995 and 1996, Gold starred in 8 television movies. Tracy's co-stars included Thomas Calabro and Patty Duke.
I think she's a wonderful actress. She has some unique qualities that I'm not even sure I can define in terms of where her emotional levels come from. And I think that's one of the interesting things about her work is it's a surprise. Oh, gee, I would never have thought to do that. Look at that, that's really good.
She's there, she's full, and she listens. You know, she doesn't hang back. You know, she gives her all.
Tracy definitely gave her all when she played the bad girl in the 1996 television film Face of Evil, co-starring Perry King.
I think she was having a lot of fun playing this person that she was never going to let out in real life. But, you know, we all have that side of us.
I got to play somebody so mean, and that's, you know, like not normally my nature.
Off camera, Tracy was about to take on one of her most important roles. In the summer of 1996, she became pregnant for the first time.
She just came alive during that time. I've never seen her more alive. She just opens up like a flower and just radiates life.
It was just perfect. I loved being pregnant. I never felt better. I never, you know, felt more at peace. And I always say it was because Sage was inside of me.
Tracy gave birth to her son, Sage Marshall, on February 16, 1997. 2 years later, on March 4th, 1999, Tracy and Robbie had a second child, a boy named Bailey.
I was just in this glow of, like, maternal bliss. I just felt like I had created giving birth, you know.
Her first alliance, her first love is to her boys. And she adores them, she loves them, and she gives them everything.
And being a mother changes everything. Because it's no more about you, and anorexia and everything I'd been through had been very selfish. It is. It's all about you. And anytime any kind of feeling like that comes in, it's like, wait a minute, you know what? I brought these two babies here. I made that decision. So it's up to me to give them the right environment, the right life.
It's made her a much better person and much happier.
Coming up, Tracy's busy future.
It's everything that I've ever dreamed of.
Tonight on E! At 7, Celebrity Profile takes an in-depth look at actress Tracy Gold. At 8, it's Vegas Weddings, the E! Original Special. At 9, the E! True Hollywood Story tells the full tale of 7 stranded castaways, Gilligan's Island. Tonight, starting at 7, only on E! Before you say those 3 little words...
Yes, I do.
Explore your options.
Viva Las Vegas!
From a hot air balloon to a drive-thru ceremony, anything goes at the altar. Vegas Weddings, coming up next, only on E!
Wood, leather, adrenaline. The new Lincoln LS, Motor Trend Car of the Year. Should have used Energizer. They keep going and going and going and going.
More reasons to shop Pier 1 now. Hundreds of great gift ideas.
For everyone on your list. Great gifts.
Great style.
Great value.
All at Pier 1, only at Pier 1.
It's time to shop.
At Pier 1, the gift place.
With the power of the Pentium 3 processor, don't just get onto the internet, get into it at intel.com.
In this-
this life, there's just no stopping. No break for a hacking cough, raw sore throat, fever. But there is Theraflu. Fast, soothing, hot liquid therapy. Maximum strength Theraflu. Instant comfort, powerful relief.
What are your favorite moments of the millennium? A special time with family? A celebration with friends? Or one of mankind's greatest journeys? Now you can have them all on one special Kodak Picture CD that's yours free. It contains all your Kodak pictures from your latest roll of film, plus excerpts from life's collection of the greatest pictures of the 20th century. Look for this free, limited-time offer at participating Kodak retailers.
This portion of E is brought to you by Kodak Picture CD. Everything you need to organize, enhance, and share your pictures on your PC.
In 1999, 30-year-old Tracy Gold remained very much in demand as an actress.
Tracy is a wonderful young actress, and the fact that she has hung in there and still has an active career in this business, starting as young as she did, I think is a real testament to her perseverance and her talent.
In the 1999 television film Shattered Trust, Tracy acted with her younger sister Jessie for the first time.
It's been great being with Tracy this whole time, because I'm new at this, and if I need to ask a question, I'll just go up to her and I'll be like, "Jessie, can you help me?" And she'll do it for me, and she won't even question, but I think she likes when I ask her to do things.
I do. It makes me feel very important.
Important and confident.
I think the little girl that couldn't stand up and ask for something that was really necessary, that she needed, or make a complaint, can now put her foot down and say, "I need this."
I think that I take care of myself more than I ever have. She's learned that in order for her to have what she wants, which is a happy family, she has to be healthy.
Tracy's family has always mattered most to her. It still does.
Sometimes it seems like it's not even happening, because that's what I always wanted. I always wanted, ever since I was a little girl, to be madly in love and have this amazing husband that I love so much, and I do.
They're soulmates. Robbie's gone through hard times with Tracy. Tracy's gone through rough times with Robbie. And the two of them are spiritually, physically attached for life.
If we're lucky enough, I want to have 5, 6 kids. You know, she's amazing. She's the greatest mother I've ever seen.
The little family that I've created with my husband, and that's, to me, an amazing thing. When I look at my boys and I look at my husband, and we have a house, and we have, it's everything that I've ever dreamed of.
I'm so proud of her, that she overcame all of this, and that she's moving into her life with such beauty and grace.
There's no word to describe what I feel for Tracy. It's not pride, it's just sheer love.
These are the good old days. You know, these are the days when I look back on, oh my God, these are my babies. These are, you know, this is what it's all about right here, you know? And the movies and everything are great, but they're nothing if you don't have the other things. And so I'm really fortunate I have everything. Not to sound gloating, but, you know, I feel like I've worked really hard for it.
Something old world, something new wave, something borrowed, something blue suede. Up next, Vegas weddings, where anything goes at the altar.
A nice round of applause.